So, another Friday is upon us.
Killing everyone out there was a...
Those who win all six games will receive a handsome cash prize.
It's the Cooper and Anthony Show.
Married people are sharing their wildest secrets that they will never tell their spouse.
Oh, you know, what do you think about that? Do you think that there's some things that we should keep from each other, or do you think that we should... Do you think we should tell each other everything? What's your thought?
No, I think when you hear some of these stories and they're all hashtag anonymous, you're going to say nothing good can ever come out of you telling your spouse.
Oh, okay.
Like this guy said, I've had sex with all three of my wife's sisters multiple times.
What?
I also had one secret child with her oldest sister. She would kill me if she even heard a rumor about it.
She knows. How do you not know? Your husband is sleeping with... You've got three sisters who are all sleeping with your husband, and one of them has a baby with him. You don't look at the baby and go, huh, that baby looks a little familiar.
But yeah, those secrets, you don't tell your spouse.
The way I feel about affairs in general, I think if you're having an affair and then it's over and it didn't mean anything and it's not going to mess up your marriage or relationship, telling your spouse only makes you feel better. I think if the relationship is over, you should not tell your spouse, go to your grave with it, because there's no reason to uproot and upend your entire relationship.
This person, hashtag anonymous, I posed for Playboy when I was 18. I kept it secret from my husband for years.
Why wouldn't you lead with that? Hi, nice to meet you. I posed for Playboy when I was 18.
Depends on who you're dating, I guess.
Yeah, but you could just Google that now. I mean, it's out there. That's one of those things that, like, you can't hide that.
Here's another anonymous. I've never told my husband that I absolutely hate the three kids he has from his previous marriage. I despise them since the moment I met them. I can't stand them at all. They disgust me. I like nothing about them.
Wow, that's a big secret to keep, because that's the dude's kids. I want to know more about that. I want to know, like, because I always wonder, like, so is the problem you? Are you the nightmare, or are these kids truly, like, assholes? Or how could all three of them be assholes? I don't know. I need more information there.
Yeah, I mean, kids are assholes. I love this. Hashtag anonymous. My wife has no idea I gave oral sex to her brother-in-law.
Wait. So the husband had a gay
sex experience
with her brother-in-law. How did that I need more information. How did that come about? Where were you? Did you is the brother-in-law gay, or is it one of those things that you guys were just like, it was a moment?
Watching,
like,
a
I need more information.
Watching a football game and go, hey, you wanna? I paid off my college bills, $3,000, by performing in adult videos behind my wife's back.
That's a good one. That's a really good one.
Yeah. How did you pay that off? I just did. I've been married into...
I saved like crazy.
That's how
I stopped drinking coffee. You know, yeah. Because, you know, coffees are expensive. So coffee a day. Yeah, I found a way to do it.
Made a sandwich for myself every single day. That's how I did it. I've been married and divorced before, but my current husband thinks this is my first marriage. So completely lied.
I want to know why. Is it because she wanted him to think that he was her first and it was special? Because the thing is, why was she married before? Was it one of those things that they were young and they got married and it was a mistake? Or is the guy on the lam? Like, I need more information.
A week before I married my wife, I really got drunk with my best friend, a man like me, and we ended up making out and giving each other oral sex. During the whole ceremony, we kept exchanging awkward glimpses.
Wow, that's weird. See, that's what I understand. So if you're bisexual, you have to say to the person you're with, I'm bisexual, and once in a while, I'd like to... You know, suck a dick.
Well,
like, you need to.
It was the day.
That's what makes me sad.
It was the day before the wedding, so I don't think he had a chance.
No, what I'm saying is, now that they're married and she doesn't know, that means he's probably on Grindr and doing it privately. I just think that's the kind of thing that you should let your significant other know.
That it's more sad than
Yeah, it makes me sad that you can't be who you are. Yeah.
My husband doesn't know I have silicone injections in my ass.
Well, that's an okay secret. That's none of anybody's business.
My husband thinks I finished my bachelor degree. I didn't. I dropped out and faked it.
Ooh. That's, yeah. I mean, faking orgasms is one thing, but faking an education, girl, uh-uh.
I got pregnant the very first time with my now husband and I slept together. I was in my early 20s, didn't know him very well, and I had an abortion. Never told him.
Wow. That's a biggie. That's a biggie, especially like, do they have kids now? Do they not have kids? Are they having trouble having kids? You know what I mean? Like, that would be big. Can you imagine, like, you finally, like, get ready to have kids and you're mature enough and you can't do it and you need to do in vitro. And it's like, yeah, but you know what? It wasn't right for her. Having a baby was not right for her at 20.
Yeah.
But she should have told him. Yeah, that's the kind of thing. It's your husband. You got to tell him that.
My boss got me into online gambling. I lost more than $500 incredibly quickly and kept it a secret from my husband.
That's the male equivalent of women that go out and they shop and they spend $500 and they hide their purchases, like in the trunk of their car or in their garage. We hear about that all the time.
I've been lying to my husband about my eye color for our entire relationship. He has poor eyesight and couldn't tell that I wore contacts, but I've been wearing contacts for 10 years now and I never take them out.
Oh, that's weird. That one's weird.
Okay. Here's another hashtag anonymous. My partner, who's a female of 6 years, didn't know that before we met, I used to sleep with men. The experiences were very hot, and I often reminisce about them.
Again, there's somebody who... See, okay, so there are people that are... what is the sexuality where you fall in love with the person and not the... genitals, like you're not bi, you're right. Not straight, you're
pansexual.
Not gay. No, it's not pansexual. It's another one that we just learned about, that we talked about recently. I can't remember. But it's an identity where it's like you fall in love with the person.
Right.
Rather than like I'm bi or I'm straight or I'm gay, you just... Because... So this might be somebody that's the situation, but I think that's the kind of thing you should share with... You got to talk about your past and who you've been, you know? That's weird to... I think that's weird to not tell.
All right. Here's a hashtag anonymous that I don't think you should tell your husband. I don't think you should tell anybody. I don't think you should even put it on BuzzFeed like this person did.
Okay.
When I get out of the shower, I often dry off with a towel. However, for some reason, my butt crack is never dry enough. So every time I walk to the bedroom to get dressed, I secretly use my husband's side of the blanket to finish drying my butt crack.
That's just weird. That is just weird.
When you use his blanket, yeah.
But like, how would you feel? Yeah, how would you feel if, like, someone told you that? If the woman in your life was like, listen, I have a secret to share with you. And that's what the secret was. You'd be like, do I have a secret kid somewhere? You know, like, how big is the secret? I use your side of the bed blanket to dry my ass? Like, I feel like that's such a passive-aggressive thing. Like, you want to, you know, you want to tell him to go fuck himself, but instead, you just dry your ass on his side of the bed sheets.
You're like a dog.
Right.
It scoots along the blanket. My biggest secret is that I'm only staying married to him for financial reasons. We've been together for 15 years, and I only stay with him because he has money.
Honey, that is not a secret. That's half of New York.
But she's never told him, though.
Oh, he knows.
I'm a woman and my husband thinks that my number of sexual partners is a lot lower than it actually is. My number is in the 80s. I told him it was only 18.
I know a lot of women that do that.
In the 80s?
I go the other way. Yeah, I go the other way. I'm like, you know, it's probably like closer to 200. What's that basketball player that had all the conquests? Yeah, it's probably closer to that.
You're like the female Wilt Chamberlain. Is that what you're telling me?
Yeah.
I've been married for 7 years, faked every single orgasm with my husband.
That's just sad.
That's wrong.
That's sad. I mean, if you don't know how to have an orgasm, or if it's because you're not attracted to him and you're just faking it, then seriously, get divorced. Let him go. Go find somebody that you're attracted to. That's sad.
My mom's friend won $4.5 million in the lottery, didn't tell her husband for almost 2 years.
Yeah, that I get. I understand that.
Come on, bitches.
It's the Cooper and Anthony Show.
So I'm going to need to hear it. Come now.
Let me ask you about your bookshelf behind you.
Yeah.
Okay, so your bookshelf is color coordinated, like home edit.
It looks like a rainbow.
Yeah, each individual shelf is a rainbow. And I'm not that anal or that good at organizing. My four-year-old really likes rainbow organizing. So Charlie did it. It wasn't even me.
Oh, that's so interesting. Because, you know, you're like a real author. And I'll do your intro in a second. We're busy like catching up. You're like a real author and a writer and a journalist and all that. So I would think that your bookshelf would look like the bookshelf of like, you know, a 75-year-old professor somewhere, and not like chic. Not like your books would be on there not by color, but by some other, you know, more smarty pants way. Because I did that. I home edited the fuck out of my bookshelf. And my boyfriend, who's like an intellect and a writer and a reader and all that stuff, was horrified by it.
My favorite organizational thing is I once went in a bookstore in Hawaii. It's like the most Western bookstore in the United States. And their books were organized by gender. So it was only books written by women and only books written by men in like different sections.
I can't tell whether that's like progressive or offensive. I'm not sure. It's like somewhere between.
It was gender, but then also color, but not rainbow color. It was like, here's a blue section, here's a red section. And they told me it was because people typically didn't remember the title of a book. It's like a vacation bookstore, right? Mm-hmm, but they would come in and be like, I know it was written by a woman and I think it was blue.
And what's the Michigan behind you?
My husband's from Wisconsin.
That's not Michigan.
It's like we have all of the Great Lakes.
Oh, got it.
Yeah, yeah. And then Madagascar is my son's favorite country.
Yeah, that's kind of where Anthony's from, too.
Madagascar? No, I'm not from Madagascar. Yeah, I don't even know where that is.
So we've already started our interview, apparently. But no one, people are like, who's this chick? Who are they talking to? So our guest tonight, who you've been listening to, is an award-winning journalist, author. She's written, is it 7 books or 8?
I think it's 10.
I think it's 10?
It might be 10. Yeah, I think so. I think it is. Yeah, I know that's crazy. It
okay.
Crazy.
Wow. Okay. Update your Wikipedia.
I came, right? Oh, God. Oh, please. I would love to know how to update my Wikipedia. If someone could tell me how to do it. Every time we try to update it, some troll goes in and just deletes everything. So I came on your show when I had my very first book 10 or 11 years ago.
That's right. I know. And I was going to ask you, so it was interesting. If you remember, we were talking about, like, I'd written a couple of books and you were like, I'm going to be writing books and I wrote this chapter. Will you read it? And like, you know, give me some critique. And you gave me this chapter and I was like crying reading it because it was perfect. You were like, what's the feedback? I'm like, maybe you can add a comma here. You know, I had like literally nothing. I was like, I mean, there's a debate whether you should put a comma here or not. Maybe you should. I don't like, that was literally my only, it was so perfectly written and so well written. And it was just like, and why haven't you been writing books this entire time? So I'm really happy that you've been writing books this entire time.
I think I even interviewed you for my first book. I think you are in Celebrity Inc., aren't you?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. And ever since
yes,
that.
So thank you.
And with your wonderful encouragement, I just haven't stopped writing books for the past decade. And yeah, I can't believe this is my life now.
So yeah, no, I can believe it because you started out as a journalist and you were writing for the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times and Glamour. I remember you wrote that whole big piece for Glamour. I was so impressed. I mean, you're like the real deal. So you're somebody who should be running books, you know. And your latest book, I have to mention it because it's just award-winning and amazing. It was the highly anticipated novel, We Are Not Like Them, about two best friends who quickly have to deal with some very serious issues regarding race. How did that book come about? Well, first of all, explain to Anthony the difference between fiction and nonfiction, because I was trying to explain to him and he didn't get it.
One's real and one's not real. I know that one, but I don't know which one.
My book is a novel, which means it's fiction, which means it's all made up. And my co-writer, Christine Pride, is a Black woman and I'm a white woman. And we wrote this book. There's two main characters, a white woman and a Black woman. But we were being interviewed by another male radio host who I won't name because I'm not a nasty, nasty gossip columnist the way that I used to be in my misguided youth. But this male radio host goes, okay, so you're Christine, the Black woman, Riley, the Black woman in the book, and Joe, you're Jen, the white woman in the book. And I'm like, that's not how fiction works.
Right.
So, yeah.
Nope. It's not. It had to come from somewhere.
Yeah, our messed up brains. We just made it all up. That is what fiction, a novel, is.
Anthony, does that make sense to you? Do you get that now?
No, I still think it's based on her life, though.
I think that a lot of authors, their first novel is based on their life. So my first novel, which was kind of a practice novel, which I think Cooper read a billion years ago, Love Rehab, was totally based on my sad, sad dating life in my 20s. I mean, to the extent that, like, I mean, it was like ripped from the headlines, real stories of the terrible men that I dated. But now, I mean, I've run out of interesting things in my life. No one wants to read a book about, like, 41-year-old mom of two living in Philly. But the book is set in Philly. That's about the only thing that it has to do with my life.
So you had to make it up. Did you get high before you started making it up, or did you?
I wish that I could get high. Guys, whenever I get asked, like when people are like, oh, would you like a superpower? And some people are like, I'd like to be invisible. I'd like to fly. And I'm like, I'd like to smoke weed without getting a panic attack. It's all or smoke or eat, because every time I tell people that I can't, like, everyone has a solution for me too. Mm-hmm. They're like, try this edible, try this gumdrop, and I'm like, literally everything makes me freak out, be convinced that there's strangers or spies in my house, and then just like sit there rocking back and forth until it's over. So I did not get high when I wrote the book. I also don't drink when I write. Like, I know I've, like, you know, there's all these like tales of authors, mostly men, who get hammered and then write a book. I can't drink and write. Like, I have to write first thing in the morning, and then I just make a bunch of shit up. And really, that's how easy it is.
Do you write every day? Do you make it like a thing that you get up and write? You one of those kind of writers that, like, you're very really?
Yeah, it's a thing. I think that it has to be like a habit, honestly. And when I get out of it, when I don't do it every day, it's harder and harder to get back into it. So even if it's crap, like total crap, I make myself write 2,000 words a day. Sometimes it takes me 10 minutes, honestly, because sometimes I just write it in my head before I go to bed. And then sometimes it takes me 4 hours, but I'm not allowed to get up and have a snack until I finish it. And I really want my snack.
You know, that's how it's same thing with dogs. You know what I mean? You motivate them with treats and it works. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah. So, I mean, this book, it's about race. It's about social justice. But all things, you know, that everyone is talking about these days. But it's also about how hard it is to talk about those subjects. And we wanted to make this fiction, to make it a novel, Anthony, which, again, it's a book that's made up.
Okay, made up book. Just say that.
A made up book. Because we wanted it to feel accessible, like, for people who don't normally want to have those conversations on a daily basis, right?
Right.
It's easier to talk about fictional characters than it is to talk about your own kind of racist grandma. So and that's what we've been seeing. We've been doing one book club a night since the book came out on October 4th, which means my kids have not gone to bed before 9 o'clock in like 4 months. I'm the worst mother.
I'm sure you're not. I'm sure you're the coolest mother. You know, when I saw that you're a mom, I was like, yes, like, you are the kind of person. When I see, I've got a friend, I won't say who it is, but I've got a friend who, like, is a terrible mother. And I hate when I'm around her and her kids. I'm always like, it's so cringy. And it's like, why did she do this? But when I saw you have kids, I was like, yes, Joe Piazza is somebody who should have children. And that's, So what does being a mom change your perspective on writing or what you write about, or does it have any effect whatsoever, or that's just like something else you are?
I mean, one, it changed, like, I am so much more freaking efficient when I write or when I make anything. It's just like, all right, girl, you have got an hour, sit down and bang that out, because look, someone's going to pull the Wi-Fi cord and you're screwed and for the rest of the day. I think it's made me more curious about other things too. So like, I did this whole podcast on mom influencers on Instagram because now I'm a mom and I'm being served up all of these Instagram images of ridiculously gorgeous women in white dresses and barefoot children and chickens everywhere. And I was obsessed with it. And so I think that I've realized, you know, not just how little the world reports enough or well on mothers, but on women in general. And I think that's what being a mom has made me think of. But other than that, I mean, I'm still the same person. I'm just more tired, and I drink earlier. start drinking at like 5 and stop at 8 so that I can go to sleep and wake up.
So let's talk about your book. So we started saying, you were talking about the fact that it's easier to write fiction about more serious topics because you can really get into it a little bit. So were you able to really say all the things you wanted to say about, I mean, there's a lot to say about race in America, and the concept of the book, or like the storyline is about these two best friends. One of them is married to a cop, and the cop ends up shooting a black teenager. And it's it's like sort of the crux of the BLM movement. And it's really told through the eyes of these two friends and how they've had to deal with it, which is, I think, really interesting, because I think across the country, friendships have been torn apart over BLM and issues that are similar. So it actually, even though it's fiction, it's also a little bit nonfiction in that way.
Oh, totally. Yeah. I mean, I think that we've seen so many friendships ripped apart just by kind of the tribalism that we've seen in the country in the past few years, and particularly since the Black Lives Matter movement really, really, you know, erupted in after George Floyd's murder. The interesting thing is we wrote this book in 2018 and 2019 and turned it in the spring of 2020, a week before George Floyd was murdered, because we'd seen so many shootings before. It's just, you know, all of a sudden the world got a little more woke to it. And right. we were able to change some things that summer, and we didn't change a lot, but we knew that we wanted to write a book that showed the good and the bad of like how people deal with race. And that meant that there would be some things on the page that people would find offensive that were said by people of both races, right? The interesting thing is that post George Floyd, we had some readers and we had some editors who were really offended by that. Mostly white people who were like, oh my God, you can't say this anymore. You're going to get canceled. Do you want to get canceled? And I was like, these are things real people say in the real world. And also, I don't fucking care if I get canceled. I'll go do something else tomorrow. I'll go like pay houses and account bills. Like I'm like this close to being canceled every day.
Every day. But you always have been. You always have. I mean, you and I would get on Showbiz Tonight and be like, let's dish about Britney, you know, and we didn't care. We said what we thought. We were experts talking about celebrity culture. But it was a different time because, yeah, social media wasn't what it was then. I mean, you and I together could have been canceled 20 times over just on like one segment.
I hardly want to speak anymore. I don't go on social media. I'm like, everything I say is vaguely offensive to somebody. Somebody's going to cry about everything. Anyway, we left these things in. We left, you know, some of the cop's family is a white family. They live in suburban Philadelphia, which is where I grew up. Oh, see, Anthony, it's like real life, because that is where I grew up.
See? It's based on your life.
You know, I grew up around a lot of, like, you know, families, and some of my family members, they would never call themselves racist, but they're going to say things that seem offensive in 2020 and that are wrong to say now in the world. And we wanted to get those on the page so that people feel like, oh my God, yes, I have a friend that says this, or my aunt Celia says this, and now I maybe know better how to react to it, or now I can open up a discussion with her because it's about fiction, it's about characters in a book, it's not about her, and it's not about me. And that's what we're seeing. Like, you know, people who haven't been comfortable talking about race are really opening up in all of these book events that we're doing. It's so cool.
Like what? Like what dish? Tell us a couple of stories that you've heard and some of the reactions, because that's fascinating.
Well, I mean, we just like did not expect. I mean, things like we had one bookstore owner was interviewing the two of us, and she was a white woman. And she goes, I was married to a black man for 10 years and we never talked about race. It's probably why we got divorced. And we're just like, wow, that's everything about that is fascinating.
Right.
You know, we do corporate events. We do a lot of corporate book clubs. And this one black guy, his sister is a newscaster, just like our black character. And she gets so much online hate. I mean, people say the most disgusting things every time she does a broadcast. And we talked about it, and he talked about it in front of his whole company, in front of like hundreds of people. And he's like, I've never even talked about my sister at work before. Like, I don't know why, but like, because we're having this conversation, I felt like about this book, I felt like I could say this and talk about a thing that's really been bothering me, but why else would I say it at work? Right.
Right.
So those kinds of things just keep coming up, and it's been really cool. I mean, this is probably the most rewarding book that I've done. Although I can't say that because I wrote a book about feminist nuns that I still think is magical. And
right, that is, yeah, that was like your star moment. I mean, I saw that book everywhere. That was crazy.
So good. Yeah, if nuns ruled the world, about badass feminist nuns. And Anthony, that was a book about real people.
Real nuns?
Real nuns. Yeah, they were real live nuns.
I like nuns. People. Nuns are really cool. I grew up with nuns. I like nuns.
I know, me too. I love them too. I think they're some of the most badass women in the world, and they don't get nearly enough credit for being badass women.
My main question for you is, when you started writing books and getting your name out there, why didn't you change your name to Joe Pizza?
Oh, yeah, because I think it was already taken on Instagram.
Oh, see, that would have been a great name, because you're trying to be Joe Piazza. It's just much easier to be Pizza.
Well, everybody loves pizza, yeah.
Right. Mm.
You know, then I wouldn't get asked literally every day, are you related to the baseball player? Which I'm not. But one time I did get really good Mets tickets because I showed them my driver's license when I was like 24 years old and poor and living in New York City, Shea Stadium. And they just gave me some really good seats. I don't know who Mike Piazza left them for, but they were mine that day.
Yeah.
Oh,
but
that's pretty cool.
Yeah. But
oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, but the name Pizza opens up many more doors because that's more famous. Pizza is very famous.
It's true. Last name Pizza. I'm looking it up.
I had you for lunch today.
That's the word. God. Like, oh my gosh. See, like that's the kind of thing that would get someone canceled now.
Right. See, that's the number one thing that you do not want to hear if your last name is Pizza.
I just found Gary Pizza. Yeah. I feel like we should call him.
I'm an audiobook person just because, you know, being in radio for so long, I like to listen to things, and, you know, podcasting and radio is sort of like my thing. How do I say this other than just to ask you straight out? Bitch, how'd you get Maren Ireland to do your audiobook? She's like my favorite actress. I know that there's like four people that read your book, but I downloaded it on my Audible immediately, but Maren Ireland, like, holy shit.
She's incredible. I mean, she is such a magical, magical actress and such a great voice actress. I've listened to our audiobook twice now, and we knew that we wanted Maren, and we begged to get her, and it ended up working out. And Shayna Smalls, who's the other voice actress on it, was also incredible. I mean, I think listening to this book is kind of like listening to an audio play, honestly.
I agree. And,
they just do such a beautiful, beautiful job that I wrote the book, and I don't read my books because I'm just like, if I read it, I'll find like a mistake or something. I've listened to that twice, and it's just because they're so incredibly good.
Yeah, and it's, you must listen and just be like, I can't believe I wrote this, because as they're reading it, you're just, it's beautiful, it's poetry, it really brings it to life, I find. You know, I think choosing who reads your book is really important. So we had a woman on, Terry Schnaubelt, who read my last book, but I was like, you know, I'm in radio, let me ask to read my own book, and they made me audition. And so I auditioned, and they said, okay, so Terry Schnaubelt is going to read your book because she's like a famous book reader. So it's a nice way to say, like, you sucked at that.
Well, you know, it's interesting because we're casting for, we're thinking about the beginning of how to cast for a TV series, because we just signed an option for the book. But you know how that goes. Everything gets optioned. Nothing gets made. But we're still in the fun part of it where you believe it's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And I actually think Marin could be really great to play Jen in the series. She's just so good. So I think that could be a really interesting option.
So if she's tied to it, is it more likely to go to series then?
Well, we have an actress for Riley already. So, okay. Who I'm not allowed to say yet, that we actually just signed the deal like 2 days ago. So that
congratulations. That's huge.
Thank you. Yes. And it's someone that I just adore, who I think is going to be perfect. Who is really committed to it too, because that matters so much to me. After my last book, an actress who was not committed bailed on it and ruined the whole project. I won't name her because that's not kind, but you could all Google it. So I wanted someone that was really committed, that was all in. And I'll tell you guys as soon as I'm allowed to talk about it, because it's exciting. So we think that will help it, go to series, and Christine and I are going to write it. So it should be, pretty exciting. Yeah. But Mary and I,
you can write the screenplay too.
We are. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I know. So we'll see. Like I said, everything with Hollywood is just like, you never know what the hell is going to happen. Everyone's like, oh my God, it got optioned. And I'm like, okay. Don't get too excited.
Well, thank you so much for coming and talking to us. And when you can talk about the series, we definitely want to have you back on. Yeah. Cause we definitely want to hear all about the behind the scenes and what that whole experience was like for you.
What is this?
Sounds like something I heard before.
It's the Cooper and Anthony Show.
Open mic night. Call in with anything. Got something you need to get off your chest?
Thank you. I love your show and I love your crew.
Hi, Hannah.
Hi. I just want to tell you guys that I got my driver's permit today.
That's a major milestone. Wow. You must be so excited.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I finally graduated from backing up the driveway to actually going around the neighborhood.
Are you going to text and drive at the same time?
No, it's illegal.
Thank you, Sue.
Anna, are you going to text and drive at the same time?
No, she said no.
I'm going to pull over.
Oh, yeah, right.
And turn off the car and text if I really have to.
Wow. Want to sing?
And another. There you go.
Call Cooper now, 877-6-COOPER. This is the Cooper Lawrence Show.
Okay, it's open mic night, which means my microphone is your microphone. Any chance you wanted to ever be on the radio and talk and just get something off your chest or sing a song or whatever you got, this is your opportunity. Just call 877-6-COOPER or 877-626-6737, and that's it. It's all yours. That's how open mic, that's how simple open mic Thursday is.
Very simple.
Very easy. You call, you talk, we let you say whatever you want. Topic's all yours. It's the artist formerly known as William. Hello, Jabri.
Hey, Cooper.
So what do you got for us tonight?
Okay, I have to crank this out real quick for Chad. Okay, top 5 metal songs that I like right now.
Oh, okay.
No. All right.
I thought I was getting house episodes, but okay.
You are, just have to get this out really quick. Servants of the Night by Arsis. Number 5. Number 4, 94 Hours by As I Lay Dying.
Mm.
Number 3, In the Belly of a Shark by Gallows.
That's my mother's favorite.
Number 2, Into the Maelstrom by A Band of Orcs. And number 1.
A Band of Dorks?
Yes.
Band of Orcs.
Oh, like Mork.
And number 1, Tooth Grinder by Animosity. Okay, house episodes. Number 5, House versus God, when House gets that one patient who's really religious and blah, blah, blah. Number 4, Fidelity, where a guy's wife cheats on...
I love that episode.
Yeah, that was a good episode.
It was a great episode.
And The Jerk, where this really jerky kid beats this kid up because he beat him in chess, apparently.
Oh, yeah, I remember that one.
And this is my mom. My mom told me to put this on here. 2 Lines in the Sand, the one with the autistic kid who gave House his PSP.
Right. Oh, that was, I cried. That was amazing.
And my favorite episode, 3 Stories, about the 3 people who come into a clinic whose leg hurts. House does it for a session or something.
I love that one too. But I'm surprised you didn't put the one, the season finale from, I don't know if it was last year or the year before, with the House has the dream and the guy's eyes pop out.
Oh, yeah, that one.
That's the coolest
and
one.
When House got shot.
Oh, yeah, when House got shot, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty cool, but these are, like, some of the emotional ones.
Yeah, that's true. Those are the good ones.
Are you liking this season?
Yeah, this season's good, but House needs to, I know, House just needs to ask Cuddy out and sleep with her like he's supposed to.
And take more drugs. We liked him when he was
But you could tell
drugs.
From watching House that so that people are calling and complaining that the original three are not in it enough, and they either don't like the new three or they miss them, because now they're starting to bring them back a little bit.
Well, I don't know, Foreman, he's just not, he's there, but he...
Yeah,
know,
he can go away.
No, I like him, and I like him with the dynamic with the other two, and I smell spinoff.
And what's the girl's name from the original?
Cameron.
Cameron. She doesn't look good lately.
She's
blonde, I think it's her. I think it's her hair color. It doesn't look right.
Yeah,
on
the
her.
Hair color's not right on her.
Yeah,
I agree.
It doesn't look
yeah.
Good.
Yeah, they're trying to make 13 look beautiful, so they're not making Cameron look pretty anymore.
They're doing quite well with that too.
Yeah.
Notice how quiet Chad has been during this whole conversation.
It's not his show. If you called with the top five episodes of How I Met Your Mother, he'd have something to say.
I don't even know what that's about.
That is the correct answer.
Thank you.
That
wonderful.
You don't know what that's about, but you have the top five House episodes.
Hey, Ken, thanks for my pen and my boss thing.
Did you finally get it?
I finally got it, and I want to say thank you. Ken went on vacation and got us some gifts, and I want to say thank you. That was very kind of you.
Did you not get your jelly?
Oh, who I took
forgot,
my jelly?
I forgot to give you your jelly.
He's trying to keep it, what he's trying to do.
I'll give it to you next time you come down.
Hi, Ken.
When you come to my office.
Hi, Ken.
Hi, Cooper. Anyway, I just had to say this. It was been eating at me now for about 30 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I just heard the worst thing I've ever heard in my life, and Cooper, you're not even going to like this.
Uh-oh, what is it?
Barry Manilow singing Open Arms.
No!
No way.
No!
I swear to you. I was sitting here flipping through the channels, and he was on, so I was sitting here laughing at him. And I got to looking at his mouth and realized that the words he was saying sounded like something I thought I knew, so I turned the volume up. And I almost cried. Now, I did cuss, but it was, oh, man, it hurt. It hurt so bad.
That is the sign of the apocalypse. Barry Manilow singing Journey.
It hurt so bad.
Oh, we are in trouble now.
You ain't lying now, Cooper.
Oh, man.
Have a Merry Christmas.
Okay, thank you very much, Ken. Thank you. Oh, this is just. I thought Snoop Dogg on Martha was something, but I got to tell you, Barry Manilow singing Journey, I'm speechless. Speechless.
I have the lyrics. I'll find it.
Okay, you do that.
Okay.
Hi, James.
So now I come to you with open arms. Okay.
You can sing it.
That was my version.
I prefer you singing it, frankly.
No, I wanted to slap this lady the other night. Last night I had gone to the...
Do tell.
Well, I had gone to the local grocery store,
mm-hmm.
and you remember how cold it was last night. You know, freezing our took us
okay,
off.
Okay, not only freezing, but the wind.
Yes.
What is with the wind?
Exactly. It's
unacceptable.
November. This lady was in the frozen food section. She had on...
Which was warmer than it was outside.
Yeah, and she had all of her winter accoutrement on, you know, her jacket and her gloves and, you know, just everything. Her little three-year-old son was sitting in the cart in a T-shirt, shorts, and flip-flops, or little sandal things,
mm-hmm.
going, Mommy, I'm cold. And she was looking at him saying, Be quiet, we're going to be in the car, in the warm car here in a few minutes. I wanted to take a bag of frozen peas and knock her over the head with them and call DSS. I mean, yeah, she thinks, you know, about putting the jacket on herself, but she doesn't mm-hmm. think about bundling up her kid.
Well, let me ask you a question. Did you get the impression that she was not a good mom, or that this was the kind of kid that at home was going, no, I'm not putting on a coat, no, no, no. And she said, fine, we're going out without one.
Well, I don't know the whole story, but it just looked awful. I mean, I don't know if the kid was being a brat or what, but I mean, she should have at least put a long sleeve shirt and some pants on him and some socks.
I guess so, but you know, only because I've seen it with my friends with their kids. So there are some kids, they're very strong-willed, and if they want to wear their Halloween costume
mm-hmm.
in April, they're
right.
going to.
Right.
That's all there is to it.
Well.
You know, so I wonder if it was that situation or if she was somebody who truly needed child services called.
Well, yeah, you're right. I mean, I didn't know the whole story, but it just looked odd to me, and that poor kid was sitting there going, I'm cold. So. And everybody else was looking at her like she was crazy, too. So, I don't know. I just thought it was an odd situation there.
I feel bad for moms because they get in these situations where the kid is just embarrassing you or making you look like a terrible mom, and you're not. You're not a bad mom. So I wonder what the situation was there.
Yeah, I don't know. So if I see her again, I'll say, hey, what was the situation a week ago?
Ask her. If she's at your grocery store, you'll see her again. Obviously, she's in your neighborhood.
Yeah, I go to a local grocery store, so, you know, I see a lot of the same people all the time. So.
Yeah, you gotta be, lady, I'm just curious. It was two below.
Are you just a bad mom?
Yeah.
You guys have a weekend coming
thank
up.
You, thank you, James. You have a good one, too. Thank you. All right, so it's open mic night, which means my microphone is your microphone. Whatever you got on your mind, 877-6-COOPER would be the number to call. Hi, Dara.
Hey, Cooper, I got something to tell you.
Please.
You know that Hulu.com that you guys were talking about?
That we love, yeah.
Well, there is a much better one.
What?
It's called fancast.com.
F-A-N-C-A-S-T?
Yes.
Why is it better than Hulu?
Because, I mean, most of it is house.
Oh.
Honestly, you ought to watch it. Most of it is house.
Oh.
And I've been watching that Hulu for a year.
Oh, really?
Well, you're way cooler.
Yeah.
Seriously.
You're way cooler than we are.
I got one up on you guys.
Yeah.
You got a lot more than one, Dara.
All right, later.
Thank you, Dara.
Okay, are you ready?
What? Oh, no. Is this Barely Manilow singing My Journey?
Lying beside you.
No.
Here in the dark.
No, somebody kill me.
Feeling your heartbeat with mine.
No.
You can hear
sacrilege.
Every word.
Softly you whisper.
Softly?
Yeah.
You're so sincere.
Oh, no, this is wrong on so many levels.
How could our love be so
Please
blind?
Tell me he also sings Ozzy Osbourne.
No.
We sailed on together.
Oh, no. They should not allow this
word.
Sort of thing. I'm sorry. And I like Barry Manilow sometimes, but when he does stuff like this, I want to throw up.
Every word. Oh, you got to get to it. We got to hear this.
Oh, God. No! So physically sick. Okay, I can't anymore. Oh, I'm sorry you had to hear that, Tamara.
It was pitiful. And God, can the dude have any more plastic surgery?
Yeah. I know. He looks like Joan Rivers.
Worst.
Joan Rivers looks like a high school kid next to him.
But, you know, she was ugly before she had all the plastic surgery.
That's true. It did not improve her at all. That's a very good point.
But anyway, I was calling to say that I love How I Met Your Mother.
That's right.
If y'all don't watch it, it is a really good show. And I have to tell you, I guess I'm half man because I loved the show that was about the bro code. That was like one of my favorites, and I know Chad's going to agree with me on that.
I do, and did you know there's a book out about it?
No, but I'm going to have to get it for Christmas.
Yep, it's by Barney Stinson, not Neil Patrick Harris. Barney Stinson, the bro code.
Well, I have to tell you, I have never seen White Castles, but he is in that Harold and Kumar Escape from Guantanamo Bay.
He's very funny in it.
Oh, he makes the freaking movie.
Yeah.
The rest of the movie's not so great. He is hilarious.
Yeah, he does make the movie. His scenes are definitely the most watchable and palatable. But I got to tell you, Tamara, I'll tell you, whenever Sean, what's your name? I always call you Sean.
Why do you do that?
What is up? How do I get Chad confused with Sean? Maybe because it's one syllable. I don't know. Whenever the guy in the corner there talks about How I Met Your Mother, I am bombarded with emails of people going, I love that show. Don't make fun of it. It's the best show on television. So clearly Chad is not alone.
Yeah. And do you watch Big Bang Theory too?
Yeah, I do, and I just really kind of started to get to like it more this season, more than last season. I think it's funnier this year, but that's my night to watch TV because I'm not, like right now I'm driving home from work, so that's the only night I get to watch my shows, you know, from start to finish. And I have to say I love House, but now it's up against The Mentalist.
Which is another hot show just heard.
That's really a good show.
Awesome, awesome show, and this week it was freaking awesome. What's that guy's like? Really hot. That helps.
Yeah, the guy who plays the, he's really hot.
He's really hot.
Yeah,
he's
I agree.
Blonde-headed Patrick Dempsey or something. You know?
Yeah, he's a hottie.
America loves How I Met Your Mother, not just me.
Well, she didn't use her real name. Tamara's not her real name. She was embarrassed to call and say she liked that show.
Right.
You think that was actually Allison Hannigan?
Think that was actually Allison Hannigan? Really?
Yeah.
Does that sound like her?
Yeah, nobody cares. You know when you eat something bad and you have to cleanse your palate?
Yes. Oh. Delicious.
Isn't this much better?
Much better.
I couldn't go out like that.
It's like a big dish of ice cream.
Isn't it, though?
It is. Sweet and delicious. Thank you. We needed that.
Yes, I needed that.
Hi, Joan.
Hi.
Joan, so it's open mic night, which means whatever you want to talk about, that's what we're talking about.
Well, one thing I wanted to think, I wanted to ask your a question and maybe your listeners too.
Mm-hmm.
I've got six nieces and nephews,
mm-hmm.
and they pretty much have every toy on the planet, and I have to do some Christmas shopping,
mm-hmm.
and so I'm trying to figure out what to get them, and they're all over five, they're between 5 and 10,
mm-hmm.
and I'm thinking of getting each of them, you know, the girls get a pink digital camera, the boys get a blue one with a corresponding printer, and they have a special deal at some of the stores, and it's four kids, they're four kids' digital cameras. Do you think that would be a good gift, or do you think that's like copping out and just buying an electronic gizmo?
I think it is the coolest gift you can give them, because kids are really creative at that age. You know,
right,
so the things that so the things they'll do with the camera, you know, I gotta say, that's probably a better gift for a kid than it is for an adult at this point. Because the adult will use it a little bit, then throw it in the drawer. The kid's gonna love it.
And I never got my digital camera back the whole last Christmas. So all the kids were taking pictures with it, and that's what got me thinking.
I gotta tell you, for people that are listening that are wondering what to get kids, I gotta say, Anthony, don't you think it's a great gift?
I think that's a great gift.
And you can get some for as low as $20 to $35. So
means it's a perfect gift.
Yes. And I love that they come in colors, you know.
Yeah, pink and purple and green and dark blue and stuff.
And are they like sturdier, so in case you drop them and things like that, they're still okay?
Yeah, they even had one I saw online today that had two eye holes for the really little kids that need to look through two eyes to center the item.
So cute.
Yeah, my youngest son, I think last year, got a camera like that. With the two eye holes, he uses it all the time.
Oh, that is great. That's what I'll do.
Okay.
Yeah, you're going to be the coolest gift giver. That's a great idea. Joan, thank you for calling and telling us, because now we know to get those as gifts.
Yeah, for $20.
Yeah.
All day long.
Please. Because that's one of those gifts that not only is it inexpensive, but the kid's going to love it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're going to be the cool auntie.
Until, like Chad said, they take it in the bathroom and go, look what I did.
Well, it's a teaching opportunity.
Okay.
That's what it is.
That's the way to look at it.
Yeah. Hi, SD.
I come to you with a pair of shoes.
Oh, no.
That may be my favorite song.
I was in New York last week.
Uh-huh.
I had a pizza from Ray's Pizza to die for.
Describe it, please.
A nice big slice with some cheese and tomato sauce, and when you take a bite, it just droop all on you.
The New York pizza. There's nothing like it.
I come to you with a pair of shoes.
I love it. I love when people put the word shoes in songs. Chad, what was that song I was singing in your car the other day?
Who?
Chad, was it in your car with you?
It was me.
It was with you?
Yeah, I'll find it.
Oh, I thought it was with Chad.
No.
Was I with you when I was singing the shoe song?
I don't allow you to sing in my car.
Wow, you are so confused.
I can't believe that was with you. Cause you know what it is? Because you got those creepy lights.
And they hypnotize you?
They hypnotize me.
Perv-mobile.
I didn't know the perv-mobile. I didn't know where I was.
Wow.
I wasn't with Chad. I was with you. You're kidding.
You were with me.
Yes. This is my shoe song.
Even
the flies. Right?
Yep. Got you where I want you.
Got shoes and I want shoes. That's what I was singing. Yeah, this is it. I was with you when this happened?
Yes, we were getting coffee.
No, I'm asking because whenever I'm with Chad, he plays that cool station that I like.
Right. It's just repeats of the Cooper Lawrence show over and over.
Yeah, that's what he plays.
Yes.
Yeah. Got shoes.
Because that's all
and
I ever listen to is
shoes.
He just listens to himself, yeah.
He does, yeah.
Here, I'm going to talk here. Listen.
He has a channel that's only news from the corner.
I say Anthony Michael Hall here. Wait, here it comes.
Here's my joke. My joke's coming now. Wait, just listen. It's coming now. There I am. Let's rewind.
And news from the corner is coming up next. You don't want to miss that.
This is it. shoes and I want shoes.
The whole time the song's playing.
That's what I was singing the whole time.
That's not annoying at all.
Got shoes and I want shoes.
So were you tempted just to open the door and poop?
Yeah, I tried.
Hi, Bill.
Hey, how you doing?
Now, how you doing?
I'm living. I'd just like to say up first off there, Cooper, Sean Lee's a lucky dude.
He doesn't think so. Yeah, you know, you really, Bill.
You must be a new listener.
I've been listening for about a year. I mean, high maintenance, sure, but, you know. Now, call about, you guys, did any of you watch The Riches?
I got to tell you, I did watch it. I was very conflicted because one of my favorite people in the world is on it, and one of the people I hate the most is on it.
That makes it tough.
It was really tough. I love Eddie Izzard so much that I was willing to watch it, despite the fact that I hate Minnie Driver more than any other human being.
She is quite annoying. But did you know they canceled the show?
Oh, because I heard it got renewed, then it was canceled and renewed. Now it's been canceled again?
The last thing I saw was posted in mid-October was that they've canceled the show. And I just can't understand why decent dramas can't stay on any of the networks. I mean, I remember a time when NBC was 4 days a week, they at least had something on. And now, I mean, some of the retarded shows they have on there are just more than I can stand to watch.
I got to tell you, I agree. The Riches, I got to say, was really well written. The concept was really clever.
No, absolutely. You know, unfortunately, to find good shows like that, you almost have to look to FX, Showtime, or HBO anymore because the major networks, outside of like Grey's Anatomy and The Practice and Dirty Sexy Money, there's not much left on TV.
Yeah, it's all CSI and Law and Orders.
Right.
Yeah, well, the Law and Orders, I mean, I guess having the guy on there from 6 Feet Under, the psychotic brother of the...
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah.
It's okay, but I mean, since the bald attorney left the show, the one that kind of went cuckoo loving up in Canada, the show just has lost a lot of its steam. And I also disliked it once they lost the old guy for the district attorney.
Yeah, it's true.
And the CSIs, I tried at one point, I had so many things I watched on NBC not to pick up new shows. I've never watched an episode of 24, though I think I would probably like it.
Mm-hmm.
When I was able to finally break away from watching NBC 4 or 5 nights a week, I thought, you know, I actually like having a life instead of sitting in front of the...
Right, it's true. It's almost like, yeah, thank you for making bad television, because now I'm forced to go have a life again.
Right.
Wow, what is this?
Seeing people.
This is the outside.
Wow. What are they doing? They're actually living and breathing and
thank
doing
you,
stuff.
Crappy TV.
My gosh. Hi, Cindy.
Hey, Cooper.
Cindy, what's going on tonight?
I've got 3 comments about things that have been said since 9 o'clock.
Oh, go ahead.
I'd be interested in all of them.
Absolutely.
Okay, the digital cameras. Walmart has the pink and the purple around $10 in different shapes and sizes.
Wow.
So it's even less expensive at Walmart.
Yes.
Fantastic.
I live there. That's, I know.
Yeah, I believe me, I hear you.
2, the mentalist, that's Simon Baker.
Oh, Simon Baker.
And yes, he is hot.
Yeah, he's yummy. He is delicious. He is one big yummy muffin.
And the third one, I forgot what it was.
Journey.
Oh, yes. When y'all were singing, they were playing that song a while ago.
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure that was not Chad imitating the Muppets? Yeah, no. That sounded like Chad when he sings the Muppets.
I don't know, but I think we need a version of that.
I mean,
go ahead.
Does it not sound the same to you?
It sounded a little bit like it, yeah. But it's Barry Manilow, though.
Yeah.
And
I'd rather hear Chad sing...
Got shoes and I want shoes.
Like a Muppet. Chad, do you know the song?
No.
Oh.
I know Journey, though.
It's not the same.
Okay.
We're on the flies now.
Okay. All right, fine. Got shoes and I want...